In the States, I talked earlier before lunch about the strife over biblical hermeneutic. There is also a pretty robust conversation going on right now here and in Great Britain about the nature of the atonement. And some more conservative reformed theologians are making a very strong stand about what's called the penal substitutionary theory of the atonement coming from Anselm. N.T. Wright and others are kind of pushing back and trying to give a more nuanced, fully orbed understanding of the atonement. When I've tried to explain to people based on the crucified God and other books of yours to give it a name, because I don't know that it falls under the Christus Victor theory or the penal substitutionary theory. I've called it the identificationary theory of the atonement, in that in Jesus Christ, God identified with the godless and God-forsaken aspect of humanity and hung on the cross. And the atonement, and this is what I need some help with, this bridge, then and what the other direction, and then the atonement also happens as we identify with Christ on the cross. So it's a double, a bilateral identification. But I don't know if that theologically, if that economic, how that economic transaction takes place in the atonement and how you would think about it, because it's very appealing, the idea to me. It's very, very appealing that God suffered, that God really was tempted. Mm-hmm. Jesus really was tempted. It's not just a nice story, but he really did walk in our shoes. And mm-hmm. that when we identify with his suffering on the cross, that's atonement. But I think that probably falls short for some people who want to know exactly how it works.
Well, we can call the first the Christology of solidarity. Okay. He suffers with us. And the second, he suffers for us. For us, the guilty, and both sides belong together. He suffers for us is a reconciling suffering, but you must see both sides together. He was given up for our sins and raised for our justification. So the whole process is called justification. On the one hand, forgiveness of sin by the crucified one. On the other hand, resurrection into new life. And the Lutheran tradition failed to see the second part of it. They called forgiveness of sin already justification, which is not. Forgiveness of sin is a negative act which clears the negative things out of your life. And the resurrection and justification brings you into a new life, a new justice, righteous life. And both sides must be seen together. But there's another point which is which was my point through many years. I tried to convince Catholics and Lutherans about it, but I cannot get through. On the one side, we have the tradition of the justification of the sinner. Forgiveness of sin, new life, reborn to a new life, etc. But what about the victims of sin? Must we not speak about a justification of the victims of violence and injustice, of sin? If you look into the Psalms, God is righteous because he gives right to those who suffer violence and injustice. So the victims are important, and the justification of the victims is perhaps the first act, because the, in practical terms, the sinners who have become guilty of their victims have always only a short memory, if they have a memory at all. But those who suffered under their violence and injustice have always a long memory. So if you, on the side of the guilty, want to enter into the truth of your life, listen to the victims, because they can tell you who you really are and what situation you are. There is no justification of the sinners without a justification of the victims first. I think we learned this after the war when we listened to the stories of the survivors of concentration camps, because we knew about concentration camps, but not exactly what happened in concentration camps and the death camps during the war. And the more we listened to the stories of the survivors and looked into the eyes of the survivors, the more we became aware of who we, the Germans, really are. And the same took place in the truth commissions in South Africa. The victims must tell the story, and the perpetrators must listen to the victims to see what they have done, because otherwise they will never become aware of. And in the church we have a good sacrament of repentance. First, confess your errors, confess the truth. Second, change your mind. And third, make good what you have done, evil as much as you can. But we have no ritual and no sacrament for the justification of the victims. They must overcome the depression they feel, that they had been weak and insulted and degraded. So they must get out of this. And then they must overcome the feeling, the quite natural feeling for revenge, to overcome evil by the good, as Paul said. Don't let yourself overcome by evil, but overcome evil with the good. And then they must be alleviated, raise your hearts to God, and find a new self-confidence, which victims normally don't have. And then they have the divine key in their hand to forgive. But this is only the end if they have gone through this process, because not the perpetrators can forgive their sins by themselves. They must be forgiven by the victims. And I think this is a lesson Martin Luther King wrote in his famous letter from the jail of Birmingham. Have mercy with these poor white guys who are so racistic, etc. Feel mercy with them. And this brings you in a new sovereign position. But this is also a long process, and parallel to the sacrament of repentance for the sinners or the perpetrators, we need this sacrament for the victims to overcome their depressions.